is pray for time to crawl. I'd unplug the telephone, keep the TV off. I'd hold you every second.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of hope, his voice to me is calling. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
For those that don't know me, I have the distinct pleasure of being William Miles Munce's brother-in-law, married to his sister, his virtual twin. They were 11 months apart. He was more like a brother. I have other brother-in-laws. They too are my brothers. Miles was special. I've known him a lot longer. William Miles Munce, a well-known local roofer, died unexpectedly on Saturday, September the 28th, 2024, after a fall. Miles was best known for his engaging smile, his kind, gentle nature, love for his family and his dogs. Miles was born June 2nd, 1957, to Geneva Duckworth Munce and Manville Hunt Munce, who both preceded him in death. He was also preceded in death by an infant son, Joseph. He leaves to mourn one daughter, Ashley Munce, partner for over 30 years, Kathy Metz, two grandchildren, Jacob Peter and Briley Blanton, three sisters, Marcia Pete Broom, Susan Jim Bowman, and Jenny Wendell Keith, one brother Raymond, stepsons Brian Katie Butler and Stephen Metz, five step-grandchildren Sydney Butler, Drew Butler, Alma Jane Butler, Xander Metz, and Sage Metz, and several nieces and nephews, all of whom he loved dearly. He also leaves a host of dear and special friends and his beloved dogs, Reese and Nanny. He will be greatly missed by all who knew him. Now we'll have a short poem by Helen Lowry Marshall, read by Terry.
Afterglow. I'd like the memory of me to be a happy one. I'd like to leave an afterglow of smiles when life is done. I'd like to leave an echo whispering softly down the ways of happy times and laughing times and bright and sunny days. I'd like to leave the tears of those who grieve to dry before the sun of happy memories that I leave when life is done.
My name is Simon Keith. Miles was my uncle. The Lord has led me here today to sing in honor of my Uncle Miles. I'm also here to represent his musical family. I hope this song comforts you. And if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I hope this song encourages you to seek him so that you can meet my Uncle Miles again in heaven. What will it be like when my pain is gone and all the worries of this world just fade away? What will it be like when you call my name and in that moment when I see you face to face? I'm waiting my whole life to hear you say, well done, well done, my good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done, well done, my beloved child. You have run the race, and now you're home. Welcome to the place where you belong. What will it be like when tears are washed away and every broken thing will finally be made whole? What will it be like when I come into your glory, standing in the presence of a love so beautiful? I'm waiting my whole life for that day. Until then, I'll live to hear you say, well done, well done, my good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done, well done, my beloved child. You have run the race, now you're home. Welcome to the place where you belong. What will it be like when I hear that sound? All of heaven's angels crying out, singing, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Singing, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Singing, holy, holy. Holy are you, Lord. I'm waiting my whole life for that day. Until then, I'll live to hear you say, well done, well done, my good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done, well done, my beloved child. You have run the race and now you're home. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay. There's always some reason to feel not good enough, and it's hard at the end of the day. I need some distraction. Oh,
you.
When I was asked to do this, I considered it a great honor. I loved him. And I struggled with writing what would be a eulogy to find the right words, the right things. But then I found a tribute left him by Eric Toohey. Miles, you were my world as a kid. You came into my life when I was 5 years old. We did everything together. You taught me to fish, hunt, and how to be a good person. I learned what friendship was, by the way. You were such a great friend to everyone. You never had an enemy. Everyone loved you. You always had the best friends. I still love you, Miles. I'm going to miss you more than you'll ever know. Thank you for coming into my life and being such an amazing influence on me. You made me the person I am today. I hope I can pass your love and kindness on to my kids. You will always be in my heart, my thoughts and prayers. No finer tribute could be written. Pass on to your kids what you've learned, what the Lord laid upon you to do. I thank Eric for these words. It made me feel better about what I'm doing because I've just got a few anecdotal things that'll hopefully make you smile, make you remember. But each and every person in here, I'm sure, has plenty of things to tell about Miles. And we'd probably be here for several hours if we took one by one, took the time to stand up and just tell your favorite Miles story, because there were many. It would take the writing skill of Mark Twain or Charles Dickens to write this, and it would be about as many pages as War and Peace. It would have chapters of love and laughter, hurt, hardship, and mayhem. If I was able to write such a novel, you would recognize Miles in it. He was always in the midst of the intrigue. The first time I took notice of Miles, he was about 8 or 9 years old. We were kids hanging out at the entrance to Garrett Park over there by where the footbridge is. There were several of us older teenagers hanging around, and Miles showed up, my brother, Dwayne. There was a couple of years difference between the two, and if any of you knew Dwayne, you know what a problem this would be. But I don't know how it got started or what was behind it all, but I heard Dwayne say, "Well, I'll whip you with one hand behind my back." Well, Miles liked that. Miles was small but wiry at the time. I did not know how wiry. My brother thought he was tough, but Miles was tough. You all know that, at a young age. So the kerfuffle began. Within 30 seconds, my brother realized he had bit off more than he could chew. Miles was beating the snot out of him. So out come that hand. And I said, "No, I liked the way it was going." So I ran down there and I stopped it right then and there because I didn't want it to go the other way. So the legend of Miles is Pyrrhus started right there. And I love that story, and it's true. Miles was around our house a lot when I was growing up. I was older than him. But Raymond and my brother Dwayne were good friends, and Miles was always there, showing up when nobody wanted him to. But he was there. My mother loved him. He had a charm. You all know that too. He was one charming fellow. And it was real. There was nothing phony about Miles' charm. And my mother fell in love with him. Just every time he showed up, she had to feed him. That's just the way it was. So there were many plates of bluegill and red-eyed bass and cornbread and fried potatoes and Mama's homemade lemonade served up. Miles even showed up a few times with his own stringer. That's all Mother asked was, if you bring fish to me, just kill them. I'll clean them. And she'd fix them. We ate well. At the time, Lower Stoner was quite loaded with small fish, and we fished constantly. After I came home from the service, we became really good friends. We along with Raymond and Miles, and it was Miles and Timbo Sires, formed a little work crew, you would say, and we were housing tobacco. We hated to cut, hated it. So Raymond and Miles and Timbo would end up in a race to see who could get to the top rail first. Miles always lost. He would end up on the bottom rail, and I would be handing up off the wagon. Being married to his virtual twin sister, I found out that she had a nickname for him. And a story about how Miles came to her rescue when kids on the bus would tease her about her red hair or whatever else that was bothering her. Miles was a pretty heavy force. He came all of a sudden with everything he had. Most kids couldn't stand that. She called him her Popeye. And those that are familiar with the old cartoon of Popeye and olive oil. I guess she was that skinny olive oil. Years later, I found a favorite nickname for him myself. I called him the Tomato Whisperer. Many of you will know that he and Kathy together raised tomatoes, and they did the best job. They're the best tomatoes I ever ate in my life, and I've ate a lot of tomatoes and raised quite a few. But that ground over there and their hard work yielded a bounty of fine tomatoes. So they would share with us, and we would end up with a big pile of tomatoes to can every winter, and last well into the winter for spaghetti and chili, tomato soup, whatever. Jenny really liked to use those tomatoes. And there was another portion to that, because Kathy always had leftovers from the year before. Miles loved tomato juice. So we would bring those old cans out, and we had a juicer, and Jenny would make him juice, and he loved that juice. Back sometime before that, my parents needed a new roof on their house, and I was just home from the service, hadn't married Jenny yet, and so I took it on myself that I was going to make that happen. I had no experience really at roofing. I'd been on a roof two or three times maybe. But I knew that Miles was working with a crew, and he knew about roofing, so I just asked him if he'd help me. And of course he chipped right in like he would do. And so it didn't take long to figure out who the boss was, so I did a lot of carrying and slinging. Miles did a great job. So it didn't take us, I don't remember it taking over a day, We was cleaning up, and this guy approached us. Actually, me, Miles was off doing something. He said, would you be interested in doing my roof down the street? I said, no way. But you might talk to that fella, because he knows about roofs. So Miles ended up getting 3 jobs from that one job on my daddy's house. So I felt like that over the years that I may have helped him gain the confidence he needed to be on his own, because he could do it by himself. Miles had some very special attributes. That engaging smile and friendly demeanor that every one of you know. He knew how to put himself behind what others needed on a consistent basis. He was generous with everything he had to offer, his time, attention, money, cold beer, whatever it was. He was loyal to his friends and his family. He had a way of making you think that whatever was important to you was important to him. He was very dedicated to his wife of over 30 years, Kathy. We teased him a lot about the time we took him to Texas. Kathy stayed home. He moaned and groaned and missed Kathy so much we were ready to put him on the plane and send him back. But we didn't. He toughed it out. He finally made it back to Kathy. Of course, he was devoted to his daughters, their children, Jacob and Briley, stepson Brian, Stephen, stepchildren, dogs Annie and Reese, and many departed pets. One spring, we took a trip to Santaville, and Kathy and Miles went with us, and that's when I found out he had serious health problems. He had the problems with his liver. I think at that point he was already stage 4 cirrhosis, or very close to it, maybe just on the edge. He also had greatly diminished lung capacity and needed oxygen. At the time, I was also stage 3 with cirrhosis. His problem was that he had hep C. And the doctors had come up with a new drug, fairly new, to get rid of that, to cure him of the hep C. And in doing so, his liver function improved, which was clearly a miracle. My problem is called non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. And it had put me in over the years into a cirrhotic liver. My cure was a transplant, because I got cancer. And there was no treatment for that other than a transplant. I received that transplant in December of 20, and I've recovered since. It wasn't to be for Miles, because he wasn't eligible. He had other medical complications. His breathing, et cetera, did not allow him to be a patient with that. On a side note about being in Santabel, it was so much fun. We woke up in the morning and Miles cooked breakfast. And any of you that have had the pleasure of eating the breakfast that Miles cooked know what I'm talking about. He knows about breakfast, don't he? He's pretty good with a grill, too. So I believe the health adversity revealed to Miles that he had a greater need for Jesus than he had realized. I know the realization of my immortality certainly led to a spiritual awakening for me, a quest to fully submit my will to his perfect will. And I believe Miles had a similar epiphany. We discussed our beliefs more than once, and I'm convinced the moment that the final breath left his chest, he was greeted by his Savior. Welcome to his eternal life. I believe he was surrounded by the loved ones and friends that had preceded him in death. If you don't know your final outcome, please search out someone that you know says they do, and ask them why, and ask them what. Talk to them about it. I hope that you come to know the truth. You cannot afford to be wrong about this. What made Miles? Was it DNA partly? His DNA, and his DNA we hear in his voice, his singing abilities. I don't know if all of you knew Miles could sing. Miles could really sing. Miles was a good singer. Well, it was more than that. His environment, yeah. But still more. Love made Miles. Jesus loved him. His mother loved him special. And he loved her back. His wife loved him. His daughter and grandchildren loved him. His friends loved him. And his pets loved him. Love made Miles, and he returned that love abundantly. That's why we're here today, all of us, because we love Miles. We'll see him again. Pray with me, please. Lord, great God in heaven, thank you for the joy you brought into our lives by our acquaintance with our brother Miles. Thank you for your great mercy and grace that will bring us together in your presence when we meet Jesus. We know Miles has experienced this already and joyfully awaits the day of our reunion in your magnificent presence. We ask you to ease the pain of our grief, yet allow us to keep Miles in our memories. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. That concludes our service. Thank you for attending. Thank you for loving Miles.